Lord be with you. Good morning and welcome. It is a great joy to welcome you to First Baptist of Greensboro. We are so pleased that you are here in this place and know that you come with great hope and anticipation as we, all of us, join together in expectation that God meets us here. And so welcome into that. We say welcome especially if you are a guest with us today. Know that we have high hopes for you. We hope that you meet God in a way that makes a difference in your life, both in worship and in the fellowship and community that we share in this place. Today, as we worship, we are listening in to the words of Jesus, who is talking to his disciples as the world seems to be caving in all around them. And amidst that, he says to them, endure, endure. I don't know what you bring with you today. I don't know exactly the content of your life or its challenges or the burdens that you carry, but I do know that many of us know such times. We know those times when things seem to be tumbling down around us. We know those times of great chaos in our wider world. And amidst all of that today, let us listen again for the voice of Jesus. It's a voice that assures us of God's constant presence with us, that reminds us that God meets us right where we are and helps us to carry whatever it is that we are hauling. And it tells us most of all that we have, through the power of Christ's Spirit, what is needed to endure. And so let us give ourselves over to that truth as we worship today. Welcome.
And as we do that, I invite you this morning to sing fully and freely. First, we'll sing together the first song of Isaiah, "Surely it is God who saves me." And I'll invite you to sing along as the choir sings verses. And then if you would look at hymn number 353, "For the Beauty of the Earth," I invite you to sing those verses in alternation. And when it is not your turn to sing, I hope you will read the words and understand all that the hymn writers have to say to us. you will say in that day, I will give thanks to you, O Lord, for though you were angry with me, your anger turned away, and you comforted me. With joy you will draw water from the wells of salvation, and you will say in that day, give thanks to the Lord, call on God's name, make known the Lord's deeds among the nations, proclaim that God's name is exalted. Shout aloud and sing for joy, O royal Zion, for great in your midst is the Holy One of Israel.
Thank you. We gather together today to raise our grateful praises to God. And as we do so, let us greet one another with the peace of Christ. May the peace of Christ be with you. It is our delight to welcome you to worship at First Baptist Church. I'm so glad that you are finding such joy in one another today. I would love to draw your attention to a few things. The first of those being that we would love for you to fill out a connections card that you find in your pew rack. Those cards help us to know if you're visiting among us today so that we can give you any information you might be looking for. But also, if you are a member, we would love for you to use that card for any prayer requests that you might have for the pastors or for any dinner reservations, or if you are seeking any information, that's a great way to get in touch with us. I'd also draw your attention to the connections insert in your bulletin, and there are a lot of things going on in the life of our church over the next couple of weeks. The first of all I will mention is the Feast of Caring that is happening here at our church in the Fellowship Hall this coming Thursday, both during lunchtime and dinner. You can come to the Feast of Caring to help support one of our mission partners, Greensboro Urban Ministry. It's a great way to support the ministry that they do. So please tend to those notes in the connections insert to learn more about that. And then I want to remind you of two very important things that are happening next Sunday. Next Sunday morning during worship is our Commitment Sunday as we honor our stewardship season. Go and do likewise. So I hope that you will consider with those in your home what you would be giving financially and of your time and of your resources and of your heart in the year to come to First Baptist. Hopefully you received a stewardship card in the mail, but if you did not, you will also find some of those in the pew racks in front of you. And then after worship next Sunday, we invite all to join us downstairs for our annual Thanksgiving lunch. It's a great time to get to know people that you might not always spend time with and enjoy in a meal together. So we hope you'll make plans to attend next Sunday. And now we'll invite the children for children's time with Miss Christina.
Good morning, everyone. I wasn't here last Sunday, and I heard that someone else gave the children's sermon. Who did that? Who was it? Your dad, Alan. That's awesome. Pastor Alan did it. Well, I hope that you're okay with me doing it today. I'm back. And so today I wanted to share a couple things with you that I heard on Wednesday night. So on Wednesday nights, we gather for a meal, and then we have music for kids, and we have missions for kids. And at the end of missions last week, I asked everyone to offer any prayer requests that they had. And so I wanted to share with you a few things that they shared with me. One person said that their grandmother was in a car accident. And so she was really, you know, worried about that, and she wanted to make sure that we prayed for that. Someone else, they lost their dog died. And so the dog had lived a life, and they loved that dog, but the dog passed away, and they were really sad because dogs can feel like they're part of your family, right? And other people shared, and people shared some good things, but a lot of times people share things that they're worried about or things that they're scared of. And I want us to remember that even when life can seem scary, even when life can seem sad, even when we feel like we don't know what's going to happen, Jesus reminds us that we can always count on one thing. What do you think Jesus says that we can be always certain of? Yes, Patrick. Yes, that Jesus loves us and that God is always with us. That is never, ever, ever going to change. No matter how sad life gets, or how happy life gets, or how unfair life seems, or how uncertain life seems, we can always count on God, and we can always put our trust and our hope in God. Can you all pray with me? And we're going to do our echo prayer, and then we're going to invite our grown-ups to join us too. Dear God, help us to trust you. Even when life is sad or scary, help us to remember that you are always with us. Your love lasts forever, and that never changes. Amen. All right, if you're in first grade or younger, you may go out the side doors to junior church.
This morning, as we gather together in prayer, I would invite you to notice the three luminaries that we have to your right today. We are remembering Philip Dunn, who passed away on Monday, Sue Weddle, who passed away on Friday, and Bob Baggett, who passed away just last night. I visited with Sue on Friday morning and was delighted to hear her articulate how deeply she believed in the goodness of God, and how grateful she was for her First Baptist family, especially her longtime friend, Sandra Knipe. Even as we prayed, she was confident and joyful in her faith. And please join me in remembering all of the family members and friends of these faithful three, but especially Pam Baggett and their grandson, CJ, in the freshness and tenderness of losing Bob. Now let's join together in prayer, and we will conclude by singing the Lord's Prayer together. Let's pray. Oh God, we are so grateful for all that you have given us, for the world with which you've entrusted us, for the hearts of those we love that you've given us to care for, for the time we have to grow and learn and experience all that you have to offer us. And God, we are so grateful that we can call on you in times of need. You are present when we feel lost. You're present when we feel afraid. You're present when things feel comfortable and easy. You are our salvation, God, and we give thanks and praise to you with great joy. And God, we ask for your forgiveness when we put our energy into the wrong things. When we choose to spend our time focusing on what will give us success now instead of what will glorify you eternally. When we choose having more possessions over giving more of our resources away. when we allow our fears to dictate how we hoard, protect, and defend ourselves, shutting off ourselves to the world. When we believe that only our own hard work has resulted in privilege or opportunity or blessings. When we forget that every good and perfect gift is from you and should be returned back to you. When we forget that our resources are intended to be shared. When we hold tight what we have and allow our hearts to be hardened to those in need. We're so easily tempted, O God. We are tempted by words like more and better and best. We are fooled into believing that we deserve so much, but you remind us, Lord, that we are not deserving of anything, but instead you freely give us your grace, your love, and your mercy, not because of anything we have done, but because of who you are. Protect us, O God. Remind us that our path toward righteousness is found only in trusting in you. Lead us far away from the images we see and the voices we hear that tell us that you are good, but that caring for ourselves and our loved ones should be our only priority. Turn us from the whisperings in our minds that say others should look out for themselves too. Give us the words to speak boldly about our faith that comes from you alone. Help us to err on the side of being too compassionate. Help us to err on the side of giving too much away. Help us to err on the side of sharing too much of your love. In your name we pray.
Thank you to Madeline Hicks for opening our sanctuary Bible this morning to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 21, verses 5 through 19. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, he said, "As for these things that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." They asked him, "Teacher, when will this be, and what will be the sign that this is about to take place?" And he said, "Beware that you are not led astray, for many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and 'the time is near.' Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, and in various places famines and plagues, and there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your minds not to prepare your defense in advance, for I will give you words and a wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, by relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name, but not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls." This is the word of the Lord.
And our thanks to Deacon Jenny Young for reading today's scripture passage, a passage that comes from Jesus' last sermon in the last week of his life as he is directing the attention of his disciples toward last things. And so we shift our focus there today as well, and we seek to hear the word of hope amidst these words of Jesus. And as we do, will you join me in a word of prayer? Here we are, O God, all of us gathered in, all of us leaning in and listening for what you might have to say to us this day. Help us to be fully in tune with your Spirit and to hear these words of Jesus as though spoken straight to us, straight to our time, straight to our hearts, and may we respond in turn faithfully and with endurance. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. New College is one of the oldest colleges of the University of Oxford. It was founded in the 14th century, and the centerpiece of the New College campus was built right around that time, the College Hall, which is this great dining hall with this towering ceiling that's ornate and beautiful. It looks like something straight out of the fictional world of Harry Potter and Hogwarts. And the ceiling of that hall is supported with these enormous oak beams. They're some 2 feet square and 45 feet long. They've supported this building for over 500 years, until about a century ago. The roof of the dining hall was found in need of repair. These huge oak beams had become overrun with beetles, and they would need to be replaced, which was a problem you can't imagine, because beams of that size, 2 feet square by 45 feet long, those are impossible to come by these days. And so they looked everywhere. And they finally wondered if they might be able to find something on the college's protected forest lands. Perhaps there were some oak trees of such size. The one who was charged to their great surprise the college was built in the 14th century, the founders thought about the future, and they knew that eventually the beams in the dining hall would be overrun with beetles, as always happened to oak beams in the end. And so they planted a grove of oak trees. They planned for them to go untouched for centuries until they were needed to repair the college hall. And so this plan was passed down quietly from one forester to the next for over 500 years. They'd say to each other, "You don't cut them oaks, them's for the college hall." What we do in the present, it has a lot to do with what we imagine in the future. Now, for Jesus, this had little to do with buildings. He doesn't seem much for long-range planning in this passage. Towering and ornate. According to the first century historian Josephus, the Jerusalem temple of Jesus' day was a wonder. It had been recently reconstructed in that time by Herod the Great, and the temple's retaining walls were composed of stones some 40 feet long themselves. The temple occupied a platform that was twice as large as the Roman Forum, was four times as large as the Athenian Acropolis. Herod reportedly used so much gold to cover the outside walls that anyone who gazed at them for too long in bright sunlight risked being blinded right there and then. Well, Jesus' followers had not been blinded, but they'd stared long enough to be dazzled along with the rest of the masses that took in this view. And so here at the start of the passage, they're droning on and on, just fawning over the beautiful stones, the adornments, all the gifts dedicated to God, Luke describes, until finally Jesus interrupts them. "The days will come," he says, "when all of this will be thrown down." Jesus is direct and abrupt with these words. And you can understand why. Remember, this is the last week of his life. After his many predictions, his growing awareness of his ultimate human demise, he has come to Jerusalem. He has entered the temple already. He has driven out what he determined did not belong there. He has claimed it as a house of prayer for all people. And as the week goes on from that conflict, his circle tightens smaller and smaller until now it's just his disciples, his closest friends, gathered around, listening in to his final teaching. They're finding it haunting, no doubt, all this talk of the destruction of places they have valued, all of this speaking of war and conflict promised, of natural disaster, of coming arrests and eventual persecution. Jesus is sounding something like the poet Louise Gluck, who once wrote chillingly, "You will not be spared, nor will what you love be spared." You can imagine how this was heard by Jesus' disciples, who were right on the edge of his passion, who were about to enter this torturous weekend of betrayal, suffering, shame, and death. But you can also imagine how this must have sounded and been heard by the first hearers and readers of Luke's gospel, early readers who were just a few years removed from the actual destruction of the temple and who were facing hostility and arrest and imprisonment and execution, and who were knowing what it means when Jesus says, "You will be hated because of my name." We can imagine how this must have sounded, because even today, we sometimes feel that things are falling down around us in a world that is full of struggle, of betrayal, of shame, of death, of abusive power, of hostility, arrest, conflict, all of it urging us always and evermore to despair. And so then, and now, and always, Jesus is asking us just where we are placing our faith and our hope. And initially, the disciples are found placing it in this building of wonder and marvel, this symbol of God's presence to them, this unshakable, lasting, enduring structure what signified pride and worthiness, certainty and stability for generations. And where they see such glory, Jesus instead sees loss. He sees change. He sees fragility. He sees something of what the songwriter Peter Himmelman wrote of in his song entitled Impermanent Things. The lyrics say this: all these impermanent things, oh, how they fool me, how they dominate and rule me. They keep me waiting here forever. All of these impermanent things, well, they're trying to convince me, baptize my soul and rinse me, purge my mind of honesty and fire. And so why keep hanging on to things that don't stay? Himmelman asks in his song. And Jesus asks the same. Why keep hanging on to such things? Because Jesus is urging us to find our hope and our faith in permanent things. To let go of the illusions that we mistake for truth. To acknowledge the impermanence, ultimately, of the places where we've tried to house God. To recognizing the shiny, alluring things on which we pin our hopes. Yes, he's urging us to admit the times that we've valued a fleeting sense of stability and certainty over the way of Jesus that constantly calls us in new directions all the time. And so in the second part of his teaching, Jesus urges the disciples in how to live when everything around seems to be tumbling down, to live with endurance, he says, to live with truth amidst the great dangers of this world. Do not be afraid, he says, echoing the words of Scripture through generations. Do not be terrified, as the angel said at his birth. Do not be scared when the earth shakes, when the nations make war, when messages of fear, resentment, and hatred amplify all around you. Don't give in to such chaos, and don't miss your opportunity to bear witness to the gospel amidst it. When things are hard, and then when they are harder, still endure. For by your endurance, you will find your souls, Jesus says. Because beyond the urgent and the immediate, what is pressing in and falling down, Jesus can see the ultimate. And what we do in the present has so much to do with what we imagine in the future. This is a core conviction of the ancient style of teaching and preaching in which Jesus is engaged in this passage. Because this is Jesus wrestling with what we know as eschatology, from the word eschaton, which means the end of all things. And our end is our beginning, the poet T.S. Eliot has written. Jesus is saying something similar. He is encouraging us that how we imagine the end affects how we begin and move and what we do even now. He's encouraging us toward what New Testament scholars call an eschatological vision. That is, a view of the world and of each of our lives that is shaped not by what is, but by what will be in the consummation of all things and the love and the care of our God. Much of what we understand of popular eschatology is a bit more sensational and overhyped and mass-produced. No, this is not what Jesus is saying, is not the eschatology that is found on popular Christian television, for instance, which sometimes urges people to send in contributions to hasten the end of all things and the return of Jesus. I'm with the theologian Lewis Smedes on such teaching. Smedes describes his horror as a young boy when he was told that the world was going to end imminently, that Jesus was going to come and take all of the faithful to heaven. And young Smedes prayed desperately that Jesus would just hold off until his beloved Detroit Tigers could win a World Series. To have a view of the present that is shaped by the end, that is shaped by what Jesus is proclaiming for us here, it's not to cease dreaming your dreams. Not to cease going places and doing things. It's not to be so heavenly minded that you are of no earthly good, as a preacher friend of mine likes to say. Actually, one of our other texts for today speaks to this. In 2 Thessalonians, the third chapter, we learn of Christians that are so preoccupied with their understanding that the world is going to come to its imminent end, to its consummation, that they had become lazy and idle. Beware of such idleness, the writer says. It's not faithful to live in such a way. Do not embrace a theology that encourages you to sit by amidst the injustices of this world or to passively wade through its trials or challenges. No, instead, actively endure. You will gain your souls this way, Jesus says. And we're able to do that in the present because of what we believe about the future. That belief in what Jesus proclaims of God's ultimate control of all things, it allows us to be people who endure, people who have hope and courage, people who persist in working for peace when there seems to be no reason to even try, and people who will not stop hoping and actively seeking a safer world for our children and for all of those who are vulnerable, people who are not paralyzed by the suffering around them, and people who know that regardless of how things look now, that we are working towards the ultimate end of a kingdom of the justice and kindness and mercy and love of our God. In her book, Amazing Grace, the wonderful writer Kathleen Norris has an essay on eschatology, and in it she explains the focus on the end of things, but also her experience that what we Christians believe about the end, it causes us to live lives of strong hope now in the present. And she illustrates this by telling about a friend of hers who was a brilliant scholar who became stricken with cancer. And she went through a period of several years of surgery, radiation, chemotherapy. She almost died three times. And then suddenly this cancer went into remission. Now, her future remained uncertain, to say the least, but she was able to return to teaching and to writing. She was able to use her energy to do things creative and productive and generative in this world. It was incredible, Norris says, and she asked her friend about it, and her friend said, "Well, I'd never want to go back because I know what each morning means, and I'm so grateful just to be alive. We've been through so much together, and ultimately, hasn't it been a blessing?" Reflecting on her friend and her action in this world, shaped by her view of what will be, Norris concludes, that's eschatology. In the end, we find our beginning. The poet says also, though, that in our beginning, we find something of our end. In other words, it's not only that what we do in the present reflects what we imagine in the future. It's also that what we do in the present, it shapes what we can imagine for the future. All of us wrestle with that largest of questions, really an eschatological question. Is there any hope for this world? Which is to say broadly, something far more intimate, is there any hope for me? And our answer will be shaped not only by what we believe, not only by what we can imagine, but also by what we do here and now. A fitting reminder for us in this season where we think about our gifts and how we're stewarding them in the life and ministry of this church, because we sit in a hall that is grand and ornate in its own ways. And so we know too that it is not ultimately a permanent thing. We know better than to put our hope and faith in a building or a structure made of human hands. We know better than to act like this world is not changing and with it the response of God's people ever changing. But at the same time, we know to live in such a way as to make the present here and now look more like the future that we can see on the horizon. The future that Jesus envisioned and proclaimed for us. And we remember all of those who have come before us and done just that. We remember today Philip and Sue and Bob. three candles that touch our hearts with grief, but also remind us what it is to live faithfully, to have a vision of the future shaped by how we're living in the present. We remember those whose lives in the present also shaped how they saw the future, not only for this church, but for this world. Those who endured, as Jesus said, and in doing so found their souls and ultimately helped us to find our own. And that's eschatology. It's not giving in to decay. It's not being idle in the face of injustice and evil. It's not living with some sense of the inevitability of destruction and loss. And it's not assuming that the powers that be in this world have the final world or have the final word. No, it's a view shaped by the kingdom that our Lord proclaimed. And it's a view that enables us to live now as we believe things will yet be. The great theologian Howard Thurman used to tell a story from his childhood in LaGrange, Georgia, about coming upon a very old man who was actively planting these pecan saplings, or pecan saplings, if you'd rather. He asked the old man why he was doing that. In other words, why he would plant from trees that he would never eat from himself. The old man looked at him and said he didn't see the problem with that because he'd been eating from trees that he didn't plant for his entire life. So it only seemed right to him that he would leave something for others. Or in the words of the great poet and tree planting poet, Wendell Berry, plant sequoias. Say that your main crop in your life is the forest that you did not get to enjoy. Plant trees in whose shade you never expect to sit yourself. Or as one Oxford forester said to another, and then said to another, and then said to another, and to another for some 500 plus years, you don't cut them oaks. Them's for the college hall. Or maybe as Jesus said to all of us disciples listening in, amidst all that's falling down around you, remember that God is raising something new. God is resurrecting something even. So don't give up. Don't give in. Be resilient, be courageous, be truthful and unflinching, and by such endurance, you will find your souls. And dear God, let it be in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. So we come now. And we respond to the gospel that is proclaimed for us in so many ways in this place. And as we do, if you have a response today that is public, this is the time in which we acknowledge that. If you'd like to come forward and meet me right down front, if you want to join this church, or if you want to profess something about your journey of faith, if you want to request baptism as part of our faith family, I would love to meet you right here as all of us stand and sing together. in this season of stewardship. As we move towards our offering and worship, we have been blessed to hear from many in our church who give in so many different ways, and we are grateful for those testimonies. And today, as we all consider how we will commit ourselves with these commitment cards expressing that next week in worship, again, they should have come in the mail, but they are also available here in the pews and wherever commitment cards are sold here at First Baptist. But as we move towards that ourselves, we are grateful to hear the stories of others. And today, Melissa Norman comes. Our staff invited her to share, reflecting her commitment to our church over these last few years, most notably recently to our children's ministry, serving in a variety of capacities, even coming back in from children's time just now. And so, Melissa, thank you for your gifts, and we're grateful as you come to share.
When we began attending First Baptist 4 years ago, I volunteered initially to teach junior church once a month, mostly out of a sense of obligation. At the time, our kids were 1, 3, and 6 years old, and they benefited greatly from all of the children's programming here. And I think I felt like I should take part in that since my kids were on the receiving end of so many great things. But very quickly, I realized it was more than just an obligation. We only teach junior church once a month, but we quickly realized it gave us a real connection to the church and the people here, and it really provided a sense of belonging for us. One thing that initially drew me to First Baptist was the idea that the church doesn't exist just to draw people in on Sunday mornings, but to send people out into the world to share the love of Jesus and to be his hands and feet. Being able to chaperone the 3rd through 5th graders as we went to Passport this past summer kind of highlighted that philosophy for me. There was such a strength in community and connection among the group, but also a real and heartfelt desire in our kids to serve others. In Courtney Willis's recent Wednesday night class, we were asked to consider how God wants us to grow as we move forward. From that, I felt like my directive was to do good, but to see the good in others each day. Every day on the way to school, we pray in the car, and that has quickly become kind of my cornerstone for our day, to do good and see good. And essentially, to me, that means to go and do likewise. What began as somewhat of an obligation has really become so much more to me. I feel connected to the church in a new way, but mostly to people who I probably would not know otherwise by serving in this capacity. And I get real joy from these kids, even if our time in junior church is a little more rambunctious than usual, like today. As cliche as it is, I've realized that it really is true that the more I give of my time, the more I receive. Even if I don't always show up with the greatest of attitudes, I always leave with a full heart and even usually a better mood. Just this morning in junior church, we were talking about hope, how we have hope in Jesus each day, but also the hope that we can share with other people, and just encouraging our kids to go and do likewise, to share love and compassion with others. Feeling a sense of belonging is so important to me, for myself and our family and other people, and I think committing to serve has provided that for me. I'm so grateful to be a part of a church that loves others so well, and a church that encourages us to find our spot and to be the hands and feet of Jesus. Thank you.
Thank you.
We thank God for all of these gifts and the gifts of all of you who have been a part of worship today, who have helped to proclaim again the good news of Jesus Christ. And one of the most powerful ways that we have seen hope and faith proclaimed today comes in Shannon and Nick Jones. Would y'all come and stand with me? Nick and Shannon come today. Sure, I'll stand in the middle. Absolutely. Nick and Shannon come today to become members of First Baptist. They have been a part of us since the spring, coming initially through their friendship with the Cashwell family. Good job, Patrick. And they were here on a Sunday in the spring and felt at home right away. And in fact, Nick leaned over, I think, at the hymn of invitation and said, "We should sign up." And so they've been prayerful about that, and they come today to say, this is our church, this is the place where, in Nick's words to me just a few moments ago, I love the community, and I want to grow in my faith and learn more about God, and that's what we all want, and we do that better together, and so we're grateful for the ways that y'all are helping us to do that. And we want you to know that as you join us, we're joining you right back. We are committed to be with you in all that is ahead. Shannon comes to become a member of First Baptist, and Nick comes to profess his faith publicly and to request baptism here as part of this congregation. I know that you affirm those decisions with me, and would you do so by saying amen?
Amen.
And you can do that in a personal way right after the service. We'll just invite y'all to stand right here, and folks can come by, and please come by and greet Nick and Shannon, greet members of their family that are here. It's so great to have all of you here today. We go from this place remembering that church is not so much a place to which we come, it's a place from which we go. And so as we go, remember the many opportunities we have to respond to the gospel. Commitment Sunday is next week. We would love to see you here in worship as we join together and prayerfully bringing our commitments to stewardship in the year ahead in the ministry of our church. That's followed, of course, by a wonderful Thanksgiving meal, always a highlight to share together in community. But also say, if you want to sign up as a member of First Baptist, next week we are holding one of our periodic joining Sundays. And if membership is something that you've thought about but have been looking for the right time, next week may be a great time to do that. But now, as we prepare to go from this place out into this world that God so loves, will you stand for a word of blessing and benediction? Now go in peace, dear friends, and as you go, it is so important that you remember again just who you are. That you are daughters and sons, beloved children of a living God, and that you are friends and companions of Jesus, our Christ. And through the power of the Spirit, the love and the hope of Christ are at loose in this world through your very lives. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.